friends, and welcome to the 15th day of this course. Today we have to discuss something which is very fundamental component of this C programming. Without this, you cannot code a single program. Any guess? We are talking about functions. In the first program, we have seen the main function. We have printed a simple statement, hello world, to the user, and that was the end of it. But we can expand it more. Not only the main function, we can have multiple functions. What is the significance of using multiple functions? What is the use of functions? In any programming language, functions are associated with tasks. You want to do three tasks, you need three functions. You can do them within a single main function. But with increasing the number of tasks, your code gets longer and longer and longer. And if you have a program as long as suppose 1000 lines or 2000 lines, in that case, if there is a glitch, suppose there is an error somewhere, it is very difficult to debug it. So to prevent such problems from occurring, we modulate our program. That means we make separate sectors. One task is to be dealt with one type of function, another task is to be dealt with another type of function, and that is the benefit of function. It makes your code look cleaner and debugging becomes quite easy. If you modulate your program, it's like the electrical circuitry of our home. When we use a particular appliance and there is a fault in that line, then it does not affect the other electric fans, other electric bulbs. No, because they are parallelly connected. So they are independent. We have isolated one system from another. That is the benefit of having different modules for different tasks. Similarly, in programming, functions help us to do the same thing. How does a function look like? You can think of a function like a mixer grinder or any other machine which takes some input, works on it, processes it, and creates an output. So suppose our input is X, which is unknown to us, that's why X. We take it within the function, it works on it, and it produces an output FX. That's all. Here we know how we can declare a function, first of all. For declaration, we use a term called prototype. Prototype is just like a trailer to a film. Before we get introduced to a film, we see its trailer. Similarly, for functions, before we get to know what the function does, prototype tells you about how the function looks. So that's just a precursor to the actual body of the function. The next step for variables was to initialize a variable, right? But for function, we cannot put a single value and say that we have initialized a function. No. The function has to be defined. Its behavior has to be defined. So we say function definition or the body of a function. That's the difference between variables and functions. Step by step. First of all, declaration. How to declare a function, or better to say, how does the prototype of a function look like? This is an example. We first write the return type of the function. That means what type of value can we expect from it. Here we have taken an integer type as the return value. Then comes the name of the function. It is always advisable that name your function according to the task that it is going to do. For example, if you have given the function name as sum, but inside the function you have done multiplication, then that is a misleading name, right? So do not give such names. Try to give relevant names to your functions. Then comes the parameters. It's a list of values. It can be of any type, integer, float, character, whatever you like. It can also be arrays. But there is no limit to it. We can pass 0 parameters and we can pass 5, 6, 7, 18, 100, any number of parameters. There is no limit to it. The only thing that we should keep in mind is the parameter types has to be mentioned before writing the parameters. See, if A and B are my parameters, I cannot just simply write A, B. No, I have to mention its types. That's all. Next comes the definition of a function. This program was one of the first programs that we did, and there we had the function called main. It is not defined by us, so we call it a system defined function. There are basically two types of divisions we can make in this way. The functions that we make by ourselves are called user defined functions because we have defined its behavior, right? But some functions exist, we do not make them. Those functions are called system defined functions. So main is such a function that is not defined by the user. So it's a system function. This is the return type integer. So we note that we have returned an integer at the end of the function. This becomes very important. Prefer to give a return value corresponding to the type that we have mentioned. Since there are no parameters, we can write void, or you can simply keep it blank. It will not affect. This is a statement. You can do anything. You can not only print something, you can do any calculation. That's up to you. Everything falls under the body of the main. Whatever is between these two braces, the opening and the closing second brackets, is your body of the function, and that defines your behavior of the function, right? So we have seen these braces not only for functions but earlier for for loops, while loops and if else statements. This determine the scope of anything. So when we apply it with functions, opening and closing braces denote the scope of the function, means from where to where my function is going to be active. Up to this much, if everything is clear, then let us go to a program. Here we find we have taken a function name. It's just the prototype of the function because we have not defined it. We have just let you know how the function looks like, its return type, its parameter and its name. Okay, the function definition is later, after the main gets completed. After the main function, we have defined our function check. What it does, it sees whether the number that we are passing, is it an odd number, then return 0, otherwise return 1. That means if it is even, then this line will not get activated, automatically we will return 1. So even if you write else, or even if you do not write else, it does not matter. So that is one way of writing that you can get used to with practice. Next we see inside main, we have called the function. This is called calling. When we use some function inside another function, we say that we are calling that function. So here we can see that we are calling the check function inside main, right? And we are putting the value n. This is the value that we are taking from the user, a number, and we are passing it to the function. The function can return me either 0 or 1. So if it returns 1, that means this condition is true, then print it's even, right? Otherwise print odd, as simple as that. Let us try and check this out. So when we run the program, there are 0 errors and 0 warnings. Let us enter a number, suppose 15, and we get that it's odd. And next time let us try out with some different value, an even number, 24, and it gives that it's even. So it's working fine. One thing you should be very careful, that do not forget to give the trailer. That means do not forget to write the prototype of a function. If you do so, you must define the function before main. Not only main, before using a function anywhere, before calling it, you must have its definition clear. Otherwise the compiler will not recognize the name of the function. So better to give a prototype so that the compiler understands that, okay, I will encounter such a function in future, so I need not worry about that. Otherwise, if you don't give a gentle introduction of the function in the form of a trailer, then the compiler will raise an error. It will say that unidentified name, or else your compiler will raise an error. It will say that check is not defined, it is nothing. Thus, either you can give the prototype or you can directly write the definition before main. Let us do that for clarification so that it gets clear to you. Instead of writing the prototype, we can directly define it. So then there is no problem at all. So if you run it, it still works fine. Enter a number, suppose 56, it gives us its even. So you can either define a function already, then there is no need to give the trailer. If you do not define and still you are calling it before its definition, then you must give its prototype, otherwise you will get an error. Let's return back to the presentation. Now whatever you are seeing in front of your screen, it is a very important aspect regarding functions. Calling of a function. As we have discussed, that whenever a function name is written with a value, that means we are passing an argument to the function, then we are calling it. We can call a function within any other function. Generally we call a function in main. So we can call it in two different ways, either by value or by reference. What is the meaning of calling by value and what is the meaning of calling by reference? It will be best understood when we deal with some programs. First of all, we will see what is calling by value. So here we have a program where a function named prime is defined. How it works? It checks whether the number k is prime or not. If it is prime, then return 1, and if it is composite, then return 0. As simple as that. Then we have used that function prime inside the main function, and how we have called it? We have called the prime function by just passing a value. This variable num is storing a value, right? It is storing any value, whatever we are giving through user input, it is storing a value, and we are passing the value as an argument to the function. So this is called pass by value, or we can also say call by value because we are calling the function, and also you can call pass by value because you are passing an argument, whichever you like. The moment we write this line, compiler takes us back to the definition of the function, and this time the k, the variable k, it's a demo variable, we call it a demo or a dummy variable. It takes the value, it takes a copy of the value. So suppose number was 50, then k will take 50 in it. So it is taking a copy of it without affecting the original variable. This is very important. And we work with that value 50. Whatever is being done here, we do that. And since we know that 50 is not a prime number, so we will return 0. And then we will print that it is composite. Let us try. So suppose we give a number 50, then we get that it's composite. If we give some different value, suppose 70, which is a prime number, then we get its prime. So this program is working properly. However, how the flow of the program goes, it is difficult to understand here in this editor. So for knowing how the program statements go one after the other, we should shift to a different editor. So let us copy this program, and now we will use VS Code. So it's a powerful editor for any language. So what is the name of the file? Let us name it function1, so fun1.c. So it's a C file, and we will create this program here. Now we will go step by step the execution part. Let us see. So we run it and start debugging. Okay, so there is a problem here. Just wait for a second. So we'll open this and make these things true. We save it. Yes, it runs now. So just forget whatever we have done for now. It was nothing related to C. It was something regarding the editor settings for running the program. Now our program is running. We can see the control is in this line. This yellow marker shows you the control. So the compiler starts checking from the first line within main. We will give a breakpoint here so that we can analyze what is going on inside this function. Okay, that is called a breakpoint. Let us proceed to the next line. After this line is executed, we can see in the output window, this message is already printed. Now it is asking us to enter a number. So if we run this line, then it expects a number from us. Suppose we give 56. Right, now we go to the next line. You can see here. Here we are checking, let me zoom it in. Here we are checking if prime of that number, means I am passing the number as an argument, this is passed by value, right? I am checking whether it is matching with 1 or not. So if we run it, then you can see the control went from here to the function definition, right? You can see the change. So this is the flow of the program. In that editor, we could not understand how it went. But now you can clearly see how the control jumps from one part to another. When we enter this function, the variables change, right? Here we cannot find the track of anywhere. No, because we have come out of the main function. So in the scope of this function, we have only these two variables. Number one, we have the variable I, and number two, we have the variable k. This is the local scope of variables, right? We have seen here, locals. I starts from 2, goes up to k, and I plus plus. So that is the nature of the loop. We will run through it. And we check that 56 is divisible by 2, so return 0. Yes, it's not a prime. The moment we return 0, just see that the control will go out of the function. Yes, so after return, the function is over. Now we return back to the point where we have called the function. So that is also a very important thing in functions. After calling a function, the function executes. Everything is done, whatever we have mentioned within the function. After the task is done, and we get a return value, that return value is returned to the point where it was called from. It is very important to note. Next, since the return value was 0, that means it was not a prime, so we go to the else portion, right? After else, we will get this printout. So let us go to the next line, and we will see in the output window we have got its composite. So this message was printed. Fine. Now this is the last step, return 0, because main is also a function, right? Main is also returning a value. So it returns 0, and we come to the end of this execution, because after this line the debugger will stop. And that's how the entire process works, right? The next program that we are going to see is call by reference, and this is something different from call by value. It's a bit difficult as well, in the sense that here we pass the references, that means the addresses. You can see the ampersand operator, address of. So we are passing the address of two numbers here, M and N. What we want to do, we want to swap them. So suppose I give you 5 and 7, you should return me 7 and 5. That's the task here. To swap two numbers, we need the original value swapped, right? We do not want their copies or demo variables to get swapped. That is the point of difference between call by value, where we are taking a copy of the variable. That means original variable is not affected. However, in call by reference, since we are passing the exact location or the address of the variable, we cannot ignore the original variable. So whatever change we are doing, whatever calculation we are doing, it is affecting the original variables. So if we want to swap two variables, we will definitely want the original variables to change, right? That's why we use call by reference for this type of scenarios. Here we can see we have swapped the variables using a third variable, and every time we are referring the value of a variable, we are using the value of operator. Why? Because we know that we have passed addresses. So to refer to values, we need this dereferencing operators. Want to check it out how it is functioning? Yes, let us run it. Suppose we give two numbers, 10 and 20. Now we are expecting to get 20 and 10. So it prints that after swapping, number 1 is 20 and number 2 is 10. Just reversed. Would you believe that if I remove these references, that means this ampersand symbols, and then in the function definition, if I remove the stars, then I will not get this swapping done. Why? Because I will be working with only copies. That will not change my original variables. How to understand it? Let us go to the VS Code editor. We copy the entire code and we make a new file. Suppose it is function2.c, so equivalent2.c. Paste it, save it. Now if you run it, then it will work fine, we know. Let us make it just M and N instead of ampersands. So now we are passing by value, not by their references. We will also delete these stars. Now if we run this program, we get enter two numbers. Let us give 10 and 20 again. And this time we see that number 1 is 10 and number 2 is 20. So they did not got swapped. Why? Because we passed the copy of the variables, not the original ones. To understand this better, we will debug it line by line. The process will start from the first line within main. We will give a stopper here so that we can see what's happening inside this function. So let's give it. Now we will enter two numbers because it is expecting user input. So we give 10 and 20. Now we see what happens. When we call swap, the control should go to this line after this, right? So if we go to the next step, we see control jumps to the swap function. Inside this swap function, the local variables are these three things, x, y and temp. Currently temp is having a garbage value. Why? Because we have not assigned something to it. So by default, any integer has a garbage value. Any value, not only integers, any type of variable has a garbage value before assigning something to it. After this line, we will get x, that means 10, stored in temp. Okay. Then we exchange x and y, and finally we write y is equal to temp. That means we are swapping it using the third variable. Fine. But what did we swap? We swapped x and y. We did not swap m and n. So m and n are still the same values, 10 and 20. That's the problem when we pass it by value instead of passing by reference, right? So now if I return back to this line, I am going to print M and N, which is 10 and 20. Whatever change occurred, it occurred only here with the dummy variables, with the dummy values. They did not have any effect in the original variables. That's the problem, because we did not pass it as the locations or the references, right? So we will get 10 and 20 printed, which we do not want. To correct this, we use pass by reference. So now if we make it correct again, suppose we write ampersand here, that means we are passing the references, and this time we write in star, and here as well we write star, and whenever we are addressing the value, we write value of operator as dereferencer. Now it should work fine. So if we save it and if we run it, then you'll get enter two numbers. If you enter 10 and 20, then you'll get first number is 20 and second number is 10. So it gets swapped. Perfectly working. I will give you 1 minute to think on this topic. When to use call by reference and when to use call by value. Just think for a moment. If you figured out the trick, then congratulations. We use call by value for calculation type functions, which calculate something and gives us a result. Something like a prime checker or an even odd checker, or calculating any other type of parameters which we want to do with a value. If we do something like that, then we use call by value, because we are concerned with the result of the function. We have nothing to do with the original values. However, if we have to do something concerned with the original values, we want to change an original array positions, or we want to change the existing values and swap them, in such scenario, we prefer changing or altering the variable itself instead of taking a copy of them. Then comes the use of call by reference or pass by reference. That's a lot of good things to cover just in the first video of functions. We have seen how we can declare and define a function. There are not only the main functions like the system defined ones. We have also used our own functions, how we can call a function in two different ways. Either calling by reference works in some places, sometimes call by value works. Since the video is getting longer and still we have a lot of things to discuss in functions, we have made an extension of this video, the part 2 of functions. So let us catch up in the second half of the session. That's all for now. I hope you liked it. Have a nice day. Bye bye.